risen to the praise. I will give thanks. I will give thanks. When the roar that I hear is the voice of my fear, try to silence this hope in my heart. I will give thanks. I will give thanks.
It's a song of thanksgiving. Come on.
Of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon, I'll stand and defy the eye of the dark. My hands lifted to the sky. I will rejoice in you. I will rejoice. I will dance in your kindness. You claim every essence. this is our homecoming. Roses in bloom, pushed up from the air. Rivers of tears flow from good times to bad. Families are singing and dancing and laugh. Father is welcome.
You too. Let's end this time of worship with a quick word of prayer. Lord, we thank you and we praise you that your Spirit is living and active, that you are our greatest aid, source of power, peace, comfort, that we find everything that we need in your provision. God, I thank you for your Holy Spirit that walks alongside us, that is everything that we need. Lord, may we lean on you as we know that you are here. Lord, we thank you and we praise you in your name. Amen. Church, we desire for you to look forward to church, which means not only connecting with God, but connecting with one another. We have opportunities not only for couples, for single moms, but also for all the men out there coming up soon. So let's start with all the couples out there, whether you're dating or married. Couples Night Out is a fun night of not only laughter, fun, food, but also some friendly competition, not only with you, but also with some other couples. So you can join us at the end of this month on Friday, July 29th from 6:30 to 8:30. If you have children, we have kids and youth events happening at the exact same time. So there's a place for all of your students, 6 weeks old all the way through 12th grade, activities for all of them happening on that night. Now, for all the single moms out there, just a couple days afterward, we have a night just for you. That's also a night where you can connect with other single moms. You can hang out and eat some food and have some games together. GV Women will be sponsoring the night, hanging out, having some fun, connecting you guys together and with God. That is on Monday, August 1st at 6:30 p.m. Then for all the guys out there, you have a men's breakfast happening on July 23rd. This is a great time of worship and of fellowship with some guys to eat some manly food. And the cost is only $5 for that day if you pre-register. Now, for Couples Night or for Singles Moms or for the GV Men, you can register by scanning the QR code on the back of the chair in front of you. That Couples Night Out is only $17.50 per person or $35 a couple. The Single Moms Night is free to all single moms. All we ask is that you register, and that men's event is $5 if you pre-register or $7 if you pay at the door. So scan that QR code, and while you're there, you can access the message notes, because right now we're gonna dive into this week's message, and we're going to discover what God has in store for us today.
Hey everyone, I'm so glad that you've joined us, GV Christian Online. And no matter where you are, no matter where you're tuning in, God has a word for you. God has a word for every single one of us this weekend. Turn to Exodus chapter 3 as we continue this study called Exodus, where we're in the third chapter. So if you're like me, you talk to someone on the phone and you meet them for the first time and your first thought is this: they look entirely different than what I thought they would look. You ever done that? You had a picture of them just from talking on the phone, and they sounded younger than they actually were. Or maybe they sounded older on the phone. You're kind of surprised at what they look like. Or maybe they look different from the picture that you saw of them. And, you know, and you're thinking, that must be an old picture that they have on Facebook. But, you know, this is what we do. We build images and pictures and are thinking of what someone must be like. We all do it, every single one of us. And the same is true with how we picture or how we imagine or how we think when it comes to God. Every person that you have come in contact with in your life and every thought that you've had regarding who God is has formed your image of who you believe or who you think God is. What is God like? And it can be different for every single one of us. So maybe growing up, you're walking down the hallway at school, or maybe as an adult at work, and someone says, God would never. And you think, okay, God would never do that. Or God always lets, or God makes sure that, or God wants me to be happy. And maybe even a religion that you were raised in, or no religion, and somehow you formed your thinking about who God really is. And ask many in our culture to describe God, and some people will say, in fact, a lot of people in the culture that we live in today will say, if there's a God, God is distant, or God is angry, or God is judgmental, God is hard to please. For others, oh, no, not at all. God is love, and God is merciful, and God is forgiving. And others will say, well, God is a grandpa type. You know, it's like the big guy in the sky. Have you ever heard that? Oh, yeah, I pray to the big guy. I hope the big guy in the sky is listening. It kills me. We have a natural tendency to fashion a God into our own image and into our own thinking. And so in Exodus chapter 3, for the first time, God really begins to reveal who he really is. God takes a man, Moses, who is going to show God's people the way out. And God begins to wipe the slate clean of every image Moses had formed in his mind and his thinking about who God is or who he should be or who God has to be. And God begins to show him who he really is. And it can take time to tear down those images that we build. They're kind of like layers that can build up over the years. And it takes time for God to begin to peel the layers away about who he really is and our perception of who God is. And it makes a difference in the perception of who we are in relationship to God. And when you step into a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, this is what happens. That one layer at a time that God begins to reveal to you who he really is. And we are transformed, the Bible says, by the renewing of our minds, our thinking. And with Moses, it started with one sentence. It was a word from the Lord. And many of you are here because someone said something to you. And that caused you to stop and to reassess the way you think. Maybe it was one Bible verse that hit home. Maybe it was an invitation that somebody gave to you. Maybe it was a message from somebody like me. And it changed your life because there was the Word of God involved in it. And that verse or that phrase stood out to you, and it literally changed your life. Maybe a crisis or a major life change. And you took a closer look, and along came a word from the Lord. And you were never the same. For others of you, a word from the Lord, what does that mean? It doesn't make any sense to you. And here's the amazing thing. It just takes one word from God, Almighty God, your creator, who formed you and who knit you together in your mother's womb. And God says just one word can change the direction of your life. One word, one sentence to change a whole nation. And that is exactly what we're going to read right now today in a few moments in Exodus chapter 3. You know, this last week as we were gathering together the pastoral staff team and we gather, we pray for you, we pray for someone, we pray for revival in our nation. And as we were gathered together and we were talking about and I was sharing with them what the message was gonna be about the generality of it. And I knew the answer to this, but I asked this, do you remember the time when God said this? I want you in ministry. Now, all of us are called to be ministers of the gospel. But do you remember that day? And without, I mean, every person, every man, every woman said, oh yeah, I remember. For me, it was one word from God, and it changed my life forever. And I was in college, first year of college, and I was heading towards a business degree. You know, business degree, that sounds good. I don't know what I'm gonna do, but a business, you know, that just kind of covers all the bases, whatever. And I was at a youth rally, and God had been doing some things in my life. And God said, I want you in ministry to share the good news of the gospel. And decades later, one word. Here's the word and the sentence that God said to Moses, and it changed his life forever. He said this, I am sending you to Pharaoh and to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. There it was, just one word, one sentence. And Moses, it was, what? Not me. And every excuse began to come. I'm not good enough. I'm not eloquent enough. Uh-uh. I'm not your man. Find someone else, not me. I've been out here for 40 years. I'm retired. And God gives Moses five insights into who he is. And with these five things, it was enough for Moses to see God's people delivered from the God King, small g, the God King, Pharaoh of Egypt, that this whole nation worshiped. So in Exodus 3, God does something, let me say it again, that was never done before. God tells Moses exactly who he is in these five character traits. And by telling Moses, it was a start, and God, by telling Moses, God tells you, he tells me, and everyone else who he really is. And God begins to tear down those ideas, not only in Moses, but God does the same thing in us. And the real focus of Exodus, the real star of the book, is not Moses, it's not Pharaoh, it's not the Red Sea, it's not the plagues, it's God, Yahweh, the Lord. So let's jump into it. Exodus 3, verse 1. So meanwhile, Moses was shepherding the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro. Now, I love this because we've talked about how Moses is a prototype of Jesus. Jesus delivered us out of the slavery to death and dying. Thank God for that. Out of the grave, out of funerals, out of hospitals. He delivered us into eternal life. Moses delivered them as a precursor to what Jesus would do. He delivered them from the bondage of slavery, us out of the slavery of sin in Jesus, Moses out of the sin of slavery to gather his own people together. What did Jesus call himself? He said, I am the good shepherd. So his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. Now the priest of Midian, what is that? He was a priest of the pagan worship of false gods, small g. Well, he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and he came to Horeb. Now another name for Horeb is Sinai. Such significance, Mount Sinai here. Horeb, the mountain of God. And there, the angel. Now, whenever you see the angel appeared, most believe, and I am completely on board with this, that this is a pre-incarnate Jesus. What does that mean? Well, the word pre-incarnate means before flesh. So Jesus now, he's God, Jesus is God, God is Jesus, God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Jesus, the angel of the Lord, of the Lord. Now I want you to notice something here. It is all caps. In the Hebrew language, it is without vowels, it is YHWH. It's capitalized. We add vowels to it so that we can pronounce it, Yahweh. It is God, unpronounceable, and we're about to see why. So the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from within the bush. Moses saw the bush ablaze with fire, but it was not consumed. So Moses thought, I've got to go over and see this marvelous sight. Why is the bush not burning up? Now, Moses is the author, so he's recounting what he's thinking. So here we just get a picture. Moses was talking to himself. I got to go check this thing out. Now, when you see fire in the Bible, it's always a symbol, spiritually speaking, of refinement. It's burning out the unnecessary so that what's left is refined, not perfect, but refined, growing, and maturing. Now, many of you, just with this scene, have formed an image of this burning bush. Some of you would remember the Ten Commandments, right, with Charlton Heston and the burning bush, and he approaches it. Or how about the animated version called The Prince of what? Egypt. So how many have seen that? Many of you have seen that in the Ten Commandments. So, you know, we just kind of form these pictures in our mind. But there are five characteristics that God tells Moses about himself that would enable him once again to see Israel delivered from Egypt. And these five revelations God gives are the same revelations to get you through the rest of your life. No matter how tough life gets, and it gets tough, no matter the challenges financially, no matter the challenges in your relationships, in your family. So Moses saw that the bush ablaze with fire, but it was not consumed. So Moses thought, and I love this because Moses, just like you and I, you talk to you more than anybody else does. So Moses thought, I must go over and see this marvelous sight. Why is the bush not burning up? If you want to get a guy's attention, set something on fire. It's like, is that smoke? I better go check that out. So, but I love this next verse, how it finishes. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called out to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. Now, I absolutely love that. Here's why. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, I believe that Moses, he was hoping, he was looking for something, maybe even praying at that moment. God, where are you? If you're out there, do you exist? God, what's next? I need some kind of direction, some kind of an answer. I've been out here for 40 years. There's got to be something more than this. He was seeking, and that's why he went over to check. There's something unusual. This could be God. This could be the answer to what I've been looking for. You know, God, would you just give me something, some kind of an insight? God says this, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. God never plays hide and go seek with you. God was revealing himself. Moses had an interest. He saw it. Jesus said, look, you will find me, and when you seek me, you'll find me when you do so with all of your heart. So when the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called out to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. Now, a lot of us going back, you know, to what we've seen, we form these fashions, and we think of Cecil B. DeMille as the Ten Commandments. Moses. You remember that? The deep voice, you know, deep voice, and it kind of slows down. They probably slowed down. Moses. How many ways can you say Moses? For those of you who are actors, you know, Moses. Well, we don't know what it was. Moses? Like a question? I don't think it was a question, but whatever it was. So we form these fashions, you know, we fashion a God into our own image. He just says his name. And Moses said, here I am. Don't come any closer. Take your sandals off. For the place where you are standing is holy ground. Everyone say holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. A fact that Moses, being a Hebrew, he would have been familiar with. At this, Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Yahweh, God says, before I begin to introduce myself to you, and this is not like meeting anyone, Moses. This is different. This is different from anything that you have ever imagined. It's different from anything that you can even imagine. This is holy ground because I'm here to meet you and I am here to introduce to you who I really am. And that leads us to just, it just kind of oozes out of here at me. It's the right posture when we approach God. And we have all these goofy ideas about how to approach God, but it's a heart issue. It's humility plus submission equals the right posture. It's the right posture. It's a heart issue. And it opens the door to hear from God. And Moses knew. Moses had a melting pot of all kinds of stuff in his belief systems and the image that he had formed. Just like in the culture today, you have people that they'll have some Confucius, they'll have some Hinduism, they'll have some, you know, they'll have all kinds of some things that they heard from a Sunday school teacher years ago, maybe if you went to Sunday school, or maybe something once again. It's kind of a melting pot. Throw a little Bible in there, because I remember hearing that, you know, don't steal from each other. But then God reveals who he is. And it was all that we need to know about God initially. Here's the first thing. Your heavenly Father is personal and knowable. He's not distant. He's personal and knowable. God meets Moses right where he is. I mean, he's out with the flocks, and the first thing he says is, Moses, Moses. He calls out to you personally. God speaks in a simple way. It's people that make things so complicated. It's so simple that people can understand. And it's people that make religion so hard and so complicated and hard to understand. And the whole passage is so simple. Moses, your loving heavenly Father calls you by name. That blows my mind, but it's biblical, and we see it all the way through. Never forget that. And we see it all the way through the Bible. Look at this verse in Isaiah 49. It says this, I have written your name on the palms of my hands. That's how intimate and how closely connected God desires to be with you. He's personal. He's not distant. Now, here's the thing. When God gives a word, it's a word from the Lord. And it may not be the word that we want to hear, but it is always the word that we need to hear. Number two, when God gives a word, it's different from anything you know or have imagined. Holy is the Lord, and he makes holy. God is saying, Moses, I know how you grew up. I know everything about you. I know every personality quirk. I know every blind spot. I know that you grew up and you were aware of me and the relationship with your forefathers, but you also grew up in a polytheistic culture. That means many gods, where Ramses was worshiped, where humans fed and took care of their gods, small g. Take off your shoes, Moses, because I'm not like those gods. I'm different. And I make everything I touch different. And that word holy, it means set apart. Set apart from what? To begin with, set apart from your own image of God, of who you formed God should be, must be, and might be. And set apart from this broken and hurting world, to be different. And to not be like the masses who are going through, as Jesus called it, the broad and wide gate that leads to destruction. Set apart. God said, I am the one and only Yahweh, unpronounceable, YHWH, unpronounceable. I am the one and only God, not like any other gods. This is still happening today. It happens around the world. In India, God says, I'm not like the millions of gods and goddesses of Hinduism. There are millions of deities. I'm not the God that is anything like the God of the Hindus in America, but God loves them, and he wants to reveal himself. In America, I'm not like the God, small g, of pleasure and materialism. I'm different. And I will make you different. I will make you holy, set apart from the emptiness of what people pursue and what they think is real living, but to give you a life that's abundant and eternal and full of peace and joy that's not related to the wealth or the circumstances in your life. I'm not like the gods of agnosticism. I'm knowable. I'm personal. I'm not distant. I'm here, Moses. And the ground you're standing on is different because I'm here. And it's far better than you have ever imagined. I love Psalm 113. It says this, who is like the Yahweh, our God, the one who sits enthroned on high? Who is like our God? And God says, be holy, for I'm holy. It doesn't mean perfect. It means be set apart. Let me touch your life to set you apart. You are uniquely created by me. Here's the next thing, number three, compassionate. So the Lord said, I have indeed seen the affliction of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their oppressors. And I'm aware of their sufferings. You think I'm blind to that? I'm aware of their sufferings. I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them up out of that land to a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Well, that sounds good. I'm tired of eating mutton. Never mind. And so now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I've seen how severely the Egyptians are oppressing them. Therefore, go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. Boom. There it is. One word to change his entire life and that of a whole nation, and your life and mine. Compassionate. And God's compassionate, not just for humankind, not just everyone, but each and everyone. Everybody say each. It's each and everyone. Your loving Heavenly Father loves each person, each individual, uniquely, just as much as the other. The Bible says, even the hairs on your head are numbered. That's what Jesus said. And I always got to say that that's a lot easier job for some of us than for others. But he understands you. He knows you. You know, all of us are making adjustments right now. At least I'm guessing that most of us are, with inflation, right? And for some of you, it's really difficult. And you're wondering, do we have to hop in the car right now? Can we maybe combine errands? Can we really afford to go out to eat? Maybe we better rethink this. When you pray, when you ask, and when you seek, God hears and God answers. Now, God answered the cries of the Egyptians. It wasn't in their perfect timing, but it was in God's perfect timing. I love this verse. It says, who am I? Who am I that you're mindful of me, God? That's what the Bible says. So here's Moses' response in verse 11. But Moses asked God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Moses is no doubt thinking, you know, look, I've murdered people in the past. I have pagan God influence. I grew up in a polytheistic culture. And I'm a shepherd. Now, God doesn't coddle Moses. Oh, it's okay, Moses. Poor Moses. He needs a self-esteem and ego stroke. And he doesn't go the other direction. God doesn't also say, you can do it, Moses. Here's some plaques to hang in your tent. Believe and succeed. You got this. The future depends on what you do today. Play like a champion today, Moses. You know what God says? God simply says this, I will surely be with you. Bottom line, doesn't coddle, doesn't soothe. He said, I'll be with you. One of the most repeated phrases in the Bible, over and over and over again. Why? Because if you really believe this, and it really sinks into your very soul, I am with you, it will change everything in your life. Moses, like us so often, didn't say, oh, okay, then that's all I need. Was it all he needed? No. Then he starts, oh, what do I say? What do I tell them? What do I say about who you are? What's your name? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you're to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you, has sent me to you. What's God saying? Here's fourth one. God is sufficient. All I am, God is saying, is enough. And I have enough. I am. I always have been, and I always will be. The greatest eliminator of worry, whatever anxiety that you're experiencing, stress, whether it's financial struggles, whether it's stress over, is there going to be enough for me and mine, whether it, whatever it is, your job, your career, the pedal is to the metal, your kids are a mess, whatever it is, your family is, above everything else, God says, I am sufficient. I have enough, and I will be with you because I am. God says, I'm above the God king, like Pharaoh. I'm above any government on the earth, God says. There are seven I am sayings of Jesus, and they wanted to kill him because he kept referring to this. Ego, eimi, is in the Greek, and it's the same thing he's referring back to when God initially introduced himself to Moses as the God I am, the Yahweh, the Lord I am. Seven, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. That's the sustenance. I am the living water. Those two basic things that you need to survive and to sustain your body just physically. I am the good shepherd. There's seven of them. And every time Jesus said that, he was clearly referring to his divinity. They hated him for it. But Jesus was saying over and over again, look, I'm all you need. When you get it, it will change your life. So many verses on this. I love this verse. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything as coming from us, but our sufficiency is from who? It's from God, through Jesus. Moses said, I can't. God doesn't say, you can do it because you're great, because you're a good guy. God says, my grace will be sufficient for you. My power, you can do it because I will be with you. Paul came to this conclusion. He said this, that's the apostle wrote 1/3 of our Bible. And he is speaking to the church at Corinth when he says this, my grace is sufficient for you. God spoke to him and said this, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Paul, you're weak. Moses, you're weak. My grace is sufficient for you. Therefore, I will boast, Paul says, all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And then number five, God reveals himself as being faithful. God will do what he says, and he will do and fulfill his promises. Let's read on. Verse 17. I have promised to bring you up out of your affliction in Egypt into the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, Jebusites, Stalagmites, and Stalactites, a land flowing with milk and honey. And the elders of Israel, everybody say will. The elders of Israel will listen to what you say. So I what? I will stretch out my hand and strike the Egyptians with all the wonders I will perform among them. And after that, he will release you, and I will grant this people such favor in the sight of the Egyptians that when you leave, you will not go away empty-handed. There's no conditional phrases. Yeah, I hope this plan works. I'm not sure. We better have a backup plan. We better have some contingencies. God says this will happen. Moses, you may not understand how powerful now, how gracious, how faithful, how compassionate, until you're on the other side of the Nile. And then you will know. I want to know before. You ever been there? If I, on the other side of the Nile, and once you have provided, once you have answered, once you have done, then I will trust and believe that you're the God who fulfills his promises. How are you going to really know how faithful I am until you trust me? And what security and what peace and what confidence to be able to say, I know the one who wants to show compassion. I know the one who is personal and knowable. I know the one who is different from anything else I can, but I know the one who is holy and sufficient. And for Moses, there it is, Moses. Everything you know, everything rather that you need to know in order to deliver my people out of the hands of the Egyptians. I am personal, and you can know me, and I am different, and I am holy. Different from anything you have ever known. Don't box me in. Don't fashion me into a god of your own imagination or preconceived ideas. I'm compassionate. I'm sufficient. I will provide all you need. These five things would be proven over and over and over again on the other side of the Nile. God says, I'm a person of my word. I keep my promises. I do what I say. You can count on me. It's all you need to face the Egypts in your life. What Egypt are you facing? Physical need? A need in the life of a family member? A financial need? A relationship? A job? What next? What's my future? God says, I'm all you need. I will be with you. Pray with me, would you? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you and we praise you that you are with us. How many times do you have to say it? You are with us. I'm going to ask you to pray a prayer with me. And you would say, you know what? I needed this reminder. I've been worried and anxiety-ridden. I've been stressed out about what's happening in our world. Father, either you're with me or not. Either I'm going to trust in that or not. And I'm going to place it all in your hands and have your peace and your strength. This is a word for someone that is listening right now, and it's going to change your life. Your life will never be the same. Maybe it was something during the worship time. Maybe it was a verse I read. Maybe it was something that I said. It will change your life. That's what the word of God. You know what the Bible says? My word never, never, it's a promise God gave. My word never returns empty-handed, ever. When his word goes out, it's out, and it changes us. It changes me. It changes you. It transforms our thinking. And it's a journey as God just peels the layers away. But you're ready to begin, and you say, I want Jesus in my life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father, Yahweh, but through me. Would you pray this prayer with me just in your thinking, wherever you are? Jesus, I confess that I need you, that I'm broken. And I need, even if it's just in one area, Lord, which you see in my life, I need you. And I'm drawn to your love, your compassion. I'm drawn to who you are. And so, Jesus, you're all I need. And I confess that. I ask you to come into my life. Thank you that you died for me. You've provided a way out for me. So Jesus, in your name, I want to make you the Lord of my life. I want to make you the King of my life. I confess that I need you, and I ask you to begin to peel away the layers of my preconceived ideas about who you really are. You're a loving, compassionate, faithful, personal, knowable God who is all sufficient. Thank you, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Would you join us as we just sing to Yahweh, unpronounceable, but his glory is with us. Let's stand together. Let's stand together.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever.
Yes.
We say glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever.
Right where you are, I want to pray for you a prayer of blessing. And then right here in Worship Live, you need a healing. Maybe it's a physical needing healing. Maybe it's an emotional healing. Maybe it's financial. Maybe it's a relationship in your family. I'm going to ask you to do something. Would you just lift just one hand like this to receive? If you need a healing touch, maybe a family member, and I want to pray for you. You are the God who heals. You're all sufficient. And there's nothing impossible with you. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. So I thank you for your healing touch, physical, touch every muscle, nerve, whatever it is, every bone structure, every tendon, flow in a mighty way, every nerve ending to touch and to heal and to make new again. Father, you are the God who provides. So minister in every way, in relationships, tear down the walls. Tear down the unforgiveness, the bitterness, anger that may be building up between relationships. Release it in your name to him. Maybe there's something on the inside of you, worry and fear, and you need healing from that. Would you release it and say, Jesus, I give it to you, and I thank you for your healing touch in my life. You are the God who heals. You healed Moses. You healed the nation as you brought them out of Egypt. You heal us ultimately out of the power of sin and grave and the sting of death. We claim that healing in your name.
Yes, Lord.
Receive a blessing now as you stretch out both hands. Father, just bless your people now with your presence. You're always there and keep them.
Yes, Lord.
And as your face just shines upon them and when they cry out to you, you hear them. You're a compassionate God. We thank you that you're always there. We can count on you. You are a promise keeper. Go with us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Throughout Exodus, we learn our need for God, just how much we need Him. I love this series. I'm glad that we're diving into the book of Exodus. We're going to continue in these coming weeks. Maybe there was something this week in the message that really stood out to you. Maybe something that impacted your heart. Maybe you made a decision today to connect with Jesus, to grow closer to Him. Your pastoral staff would love to know that, pray with you, connect with you, dive into this relationship with you. So fill out a connection card. You can do that link in the description or in the chat, or you can go to our website, gvchristian.com, click on the links, and there's a connection card there. You can let us know that you rather made a decision for Christ today, or that you drew closer to Him in some way, shape, or form. Or maybe you have a question or a comment for one of our pastoral staff. Maybe it's something about the message, or maybe you just want to let us know how much you loved it. We would love to hear from you. You can fill out that connection card, link in the description, or on our website by clicking links, going to connection card. But church, we love you. So thankful that we get to worship with you this weekend. We will see you again next week, church. We love you. Have a great week.